Hello, hello, everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hello, everybody tuning in on Facebook, tuning in on YouTube. Welcome to today's Lee Value Tools Let's Do Something live stream. My name is Emma. I'm the Urban Botanist. And in today's workshop, we're going to be talking all about beneficial insects for your garden. I'm so excited. It's one of my favorite topics to chat about. Feel free to let us know where you're tuning in from. Leave us a comment. Are you tuning in on Facebook? Are you on YouTube? Let us know where you're tuning in from today, your grow zone, what you're growing this year, what you're excited to be growing this year, and maybe if you've got some pests at home in your gardens that you're wanting to learn a little bit more about. Now, today's session is going to be all about attracting beneficial bugs to our backyards, as well as identifying and managing those quote-unquote bad bugs. In my opinion, there's no such thing as a bad bug. All insects do play a very important role in our ecosystems. But that being said, we don't like having our tomatoes or our veggies ravaged by insects. So we're going to be talking about how to manage those quote-unquote bad bugs using beneficial insects and how to attract, and not only attract, but keep those beneficial bugs in our yards year after year. So that's what you can expect during today's session. Thank you so much for joining in. We've got Dave joining in from Bradford on Facebook. Welcome, Dave. Thanks for tuning in. What do you have growing in your backyard this year, Dave? Tell us what's going on. Tell us what you got growing. Are you a veggie gardener? Are you more of an ornamental flower gardener? Let us know in the comments what everybody is growing today. I'm so excited to talk about this topic. I'm technically an entomologist by trade. I studied entomology. These are my personal bug collections. No big deal. Yes, I'm the coolest person ever. I have my own bug collections. I captured and mounted these insects myself. And in fact, these are all local species. So these are all insects that you can find right here in Ontario, if you're tuning in from Ontario. These butterflies as well, also local species. We just have an incredibly biodiverse insect population that exists here in Canada. And so many insects do so many really incredible things. And I want to talk about all of those different things. And I really want to get you guys fired up about bugs, because truly a lot of people think about bugs as the good, the bad, the slimy, but really insects are not only incredibly beneficial to our gardens, but they are essential to our life here on Earth. They're responsible for pollinating, more than 85% of our crops. And beyond that, they're food for larger species that exist in our food chain. So really, insects are incredibly, incredibly essential to our ecosystem. So we want to kind of like live symbiotically with bugs, all right? What I'm going to talk about today is how to avoid using pesticides in your gardens so that, a lot of people go ahead and start spraying using pesticides in their gardens, on their veggies, which you never should be using, because, you're going to be consuming that eventually, and you're consuming what's killing insects. It's probably not going to be a good choice for you. But what people don't realize is when you're killing the bad bugs, you're also killing the good bugs. You're killing caterpillars, you're killing monarchs, you're killing ladybugs, you're killing beetles, you're killing so many other beneficial insects by using pesticides. And there's other options for you, okay? So we're gonna talk about those options. We're gonna talk about predatorial insects that you can introduce to your garden, and also ways of attracting those insects to your garden and having them stay as well. Okay, amazing. We've got Trevor tuning in from Pitt Meadows, BC. Welcome, Trevor. So happy you could join us today. Trevor is asking, what are some biological applications for my lawn versus using fertilizers? Great questions. We're going to talk about some of those things. For starters, when we're thinking about attracting beneficial insects, we want to provide three main things: food, water, and shelter. Believe it or not, insects are attracted to water. They do need water. So, it's a great way to not only add baths for maybe birds, but also little water sources for insects. Food can be a variety of different types of foliage, foliage that we maybe don't necessarily want our insects feeding on. But you know, if we have issues like aphids, if we've got issues like whitefly, cutworms, those are all the types of things that can attract our beneficial insects. And then lastly, shelter. Similar to birds, and if we're wanting to attract birds or any other type of animal to our backyard, and insects are animals, we want to make sure that we're offering some sort of native landscape, allowing a native landscape to develop. Some people, you know, right as spring comes along, we start to brush up all of those leaves, or in the fall, you start to brush up all those leaves and throw them out. I invite you to leave those leaves be. Leaves are a really important nesting ground for a lot of insects, both beneficial and bad. But truly, if you're leaving those leaves, it's leaving an opportunity for insects to seek refuge or to seek shelter in your backyard. Now, I'm going to talk about some more beneficial insects, and I'm going to pull up some images on our screen here just to give you guys a visual of what some of these insects look like, because I really want to talk about the various life stages that, of course, insects live through. And I'll start out with ladybugs. Believe it or not, I'm sure a lot of you know, and if you don't already, ladybugs are an incredibly beneficial bug to have in our backyard. We want to attract them. We want to keep them around. So having that native landscape is great. Not using pesticides is amazing, because not only do the adult ladybugs help with aphid infestations, but in fact, their larvae, which you can kind of see that tiny one in the bottom left corner, it looks almost like a little soldier beetle. Have you ever seen one of those before? I've seen them in my own backyard, and I'm like, when I first saw them, I was like, oh, what is that? Oh, you know what? It's a nymph. It's not a fully developed adult insect. And these are what the ladybug nymphs or larvae look like. And in fact, those are what are responsible for eating the most aphids. They really, really help to control aphids. And we'll go to the next picture, and I'll give you a picture here of what ladybug eggs look like, which is another really important reason for why we want to not only not use pesticides, but to have some of those native foliage, that native landscape available for ladybugs to feel comfortable with laying their eggs and starting a family. Look at those little yellow eggs. Has anyone ever seen those before? They're so bright and beautiful. And the great thing about introducing some of these beneficial bugs to your gardens is, for the most part, they'll lay their eggs and they will come back year after year after year. So it's great. If you can, you can purchase a lot of insects online, believe it or not. You can buy them from the Natural Insect Control, NIC. You can find them at some Home Depots and even Canadian Tire, but in some cases, you can buy ladybugs online, which is kind of a crazy concept to wrap your head around, but you can purchase ladybugs. Another thing that you can purchase, and we'll go to the next picture here, are called lace wings. These are incredible, and in fact, lace wings, which is going to be the next picture that's coming up, they're like these, they almost look like a grasshopper. They're not a grasshopper, but they've got these beautiful, intricate, almost lace-like wings. And what's amazing about these insects specifically is their larvae. Their larvae, which I'll show you next, is another common name for their larvae are called aphid lions. And they kind of have that name for an obvious reason, that aphid lions, they literally, look at how they pick up those aphids and they eat them. These larvae are monstrous. They will eat not only aphids, they'll eat whiteflies, they'll eat spider mites, they eat all of those bad bugs. So if you see them in your backyard, it's a really good sign. We'll go to the next picture, and one of my favorite things that I love to introduce into my gardens, if you follow me on social media, you will have seen my video last year where I ordered these online. Does anyone recognize this picture here? We can even go to the next one where I've got a second image of it. Yeah. Anyone recognize this little sort of it almost looks like an acorn. It's very papery in texture. And what these are called are uthicas. And it's a praying mantis egg sac. How wild is that? A lot of people, look at how well it just blends in with its ecosystem, with its environment. It's so, so cool. You can buy these online as well. I actually got mine from Costco, Canada, believe it or not. A few months ago, I ordered them. But you can order these Uthicas online. You can place them in your shrubs, in your bushes, in your garden, and they will hatch. About 100 little baby praying mantises will hatch from one egg sac. It's pretty incredible. And praying mantises are one of the best predatorial beneficial insects. They'll eat Japanese beetles. They'll eat cutworms. They'll eat caterpillars, cabbage worms. They'll eat everything. They are fabulous, fabulous, fabulous. So I love introducing praying mantises to my gardens. They're also really just cool to watch grow. Usually by around August is when you'll really start to see them. That's when they get quite a bit bigger. Right now, you know, I released mine about a month ago. They're going to be still quite tiny, so I'd really have to get on my hands and knees to look for one, which, don't get me wrong, I definitely am doing that in my gardens. But yeah, it's a great way to kind of disperse those insects into your yard. And what they'll do is, in September, they'll mate, they'll lay an egg in your yard, hopefully, and replenish the population year after year. So this is a great way to introduce beneficial predatorial insects to your yard and avoid using any of those heavy pesticides. So Bill is asking, how do you deal with slugs? Great question. Bill's something that I've used in the past and has worked really well is diatomaceous earth. Some people have used eggshells and think that that works. In fact, I haven't seen eggshells working at all. I think that people believe that, you know, just the sharpness of the eggshells is going to prevent slugs from crawling over the shells, when in fact, I've seen videos of slugs crawling over, you know, the tip of a very sharp knife. So that's not gonna do what you need it to do. Diatomaceous earth is amazing for slugs. You can sprinkle it around whatever veggies or whatever plants are being affected by slugs. And what diatomaceous earth is it's almost this white powdery substance. It's organic, non-toxic, not gonna bother your pets, not gonna bother you either. But it's basically powdered diatoms, so it's natural. It kind of dries out your hands a little bit, but what it does is, if you look at it under a microscope, it's almost like microscopic shards of glass. And what it does is it will perforate the skin of insects and slugs and essentially cause them to dry out and die. So try diatomaceous earth, okay? Now, let's talk about attracting beneficial bugs to our yard. And beneficial bugs can be so many things. It's not just bees. It's not just ladybugs. It's wasps as well. And a lot of people have this notion or this predisposition on wasps, and that all wasps are yellow jackets. All wasps are going to sting you. When in fact, there are thousands of species of wasps, and a lot of them are actually parasitic wasps. Ichneumonidae is one species that exists here in Ontario. But parasitic wasps are incredible. They will find living hosts, caterpillars, aphids, beetles, grubs, to basically lay their eggs into and ultimately kill. So attracting wasps are not only great for pollinating, but also for managing pest species. And this is one Lee Valley Tools product that I have in my backyard and I absolutely love. This is the solitary bee pollen nest. And this is specific for solitary, non-aggressive pollen bees. So what you can do is you can drill this in to your fence, into your deck, and this creates a really safe home for non-aggressive native species of bees to find a space that's comfortable for them to live. And that's, again, kind of going back to how we want to not only attract pollinators, but have them stick around. And having them stick around means offering shelter. And this is a great way to offer shelter in your yard and see more of those beautiful bees kind of flying around. Now, how about plants? Of course, insects are attracted to plants. Insects have co-evolved with plants. And some of the best plants that you can place in your garden, I have a list here for the best for bees, okay? So if you're wanting to attract more bees to your yard, this is my list of the best possible options for you. Catmint, amazing. Calendula, also fantastic. Monarda or bee balm. They have a beautiful fuchsia pink flower. It also attracts hummingbirds and butterflies, but they're fabulous for our bees. Lavender. Lavender is fantastic as well. Borage salvia, which is my number one pick, and I'll show a picture of that later towards the end of the workshop. Foxglove. Foxglove is a gorgeous, gorgeous flower. We've got the salvia up on the screen here now. Salvia comes red, deep purple. It is just a bee magnet and just a fabulous, fabulous plant to put in your gardens. Another native species is Canadian sea anemone. That's fabulous as well. Of course, native foliage is going to be based on whatever zone you're tuning in from. So look up some of the native species that exist in your area, because by planting native species of plants, you're going to ultimately attract native species of insects. Now, I'll tell you guys another tip that I do for all of my veggie gardens, and it's typically our veggie gardens that are usually under attack and need the most beneficial insects. A lot of people have this idea of plant flowers together, plant vegetables together. Don't intertwine them. When in fact, I actually try to plant a lot of flowers in and around my vegetable garden. This will attract pollinators. This will attract those beneficial parasitic wasps. It will attract ladybugs that are seeking out pollen, that are seeking out nectar. So by kind of adding these little subdivisions of options for plants for insects rather to visit, you have to kind of think about, similar to us, right? We enjoy Greek. Maybe you like Italian food. Maybe you love just fresh bread. We have multiple different types of foods that we enjoy and appreciate, and so do insects. So by planting a biodiverse, great variety of plants in your backyard, pairing that with shelter, water, you're really going to start creating a fabulous breeding ground for biodiverse species, and ultimately you'll be attracting a lot of those beneficial insects as well. Now, another thing that I like to recommend is make sure that you're planting flowers that are in bloom in different seasons, early spring, late spring, midsummer, late summer. You want to have something in bloom almost at all parts during our season, and with different colors as well. Different insects are attracted to different colors. Insects see in different colors, ultraviolet colors as well. So it's a really great idea to plant multiple varieties of plants that have different colored blooms to attract just a variety of different insects, okay? Bugs are beneficial. And if you're attracting more to your yard, truly you're going to be basically creating a nice little eco habitat for our native species to thrive and live and ultimately give back to us. So I always recommend, attracting more bugs to your yard. Another thing I'll talk about, and this is not necessarily an insect, but these are nematodes. Has anyone ever used nematodes before? Let me know in the comments if you've ever used nematodes. Nematodes technically aren't an insect. They're a microscopic ringworm. But I love using these in my lawn. If you've got grubs, I'll use them in my indoor houseplants as well. It almost looks like a small ball when you apply it. They look like these weird little like juby balls. And inside there are these microscopic worms. Look, I'm not even weirded out by touching it. There's no smell, there's nothing. But you can apply this to your yards, and what this does is it helps to manage indoor pests, thrips, spider mites, mealybugs. What these do is they are a predatorial worm, and they'll eat the larvae, they'll eat the eggs of any of those nasty bugs. So nematodes are fabulous. You can get them for your lawn. Another great way of adding biological warfare, right? Biological beneficial insects to your space. Instead of using heavy pesticides, okay? Because you think when you're applying pesticides to your lawn, okay, it's away from my veggie garden. But there could be an insect that gets poisoned by that, and then another insect eats that, and then a bird eats that, or maybe a rat eats it, and then that rat or mouse or chipmunk goes and dies somewhere else. It's really a chain of events. So I highly recommend against using pesticides whenever you can. I mean, truly, there's no space for it here. We don't need it. All right. what else am I missing here? Okay, I'm going to open up the floor to questions. Okay, I'm sure we've got lots and lots of questions. We could talk about any of these bugs that we have here. We can talk about really anything. Any questions that you guys have about maybe some pests that you're dealing with in your backyard, let me know. Rita is joining in from Florida. She's curious what your local insects are and the basics apply everywhere. And two, do the basics apply everywhere? The basics do apply everywhere, Rita. That's a really good question. We have thousands and hundreds of thousands, in fact, native species of insects here in Canada, of course. We've got beetles. We've got, this is Abelis stomatidae in the bottom right corner here, or bottom left corner for you guys. This is our largest insect in Canada. It's a water beetle, a giant water beetle. So that's our largest insect here. We truly do have just about everything. Almost all orders exist here. Yeah, absolutely. That's a great question, and those methods will work for you no matter where you are. One thing that I like to do is if you're trying to figure out if you have a bad bug issue, is it's all about monitoring, okay? Go out, notice, you know, if you're seeing one ant that's crawling on your spinach, for example, might not be an indication that there is something bigger at large. Whereas if there's ants festering covered over your spinach, that's a different conversation. And monitoring means going out a couple times a day, sitting out for a couple minutes or hours a day and just monitoring what's going on in your garden. Are you seeing a lot of insect activity? Are you, or maybe you're noticing just a couple. So this is a great way for you to gauge if there actually is any sort of infestation going on before you jump into some of these tactics, is you wanna make sure there's actually an issue at hand first, right? Okay, Rita has asked, why don't nematodes affect beneficial insects? They certainly can, and I love using beneficial nematodes mostly inside of my indoor plants, my indoor potted plants, and if you're doing container gardening, because typically you know what exists or what is attacking that plant. For example, if you're seeing thrips on that plant, if you're seeing mealybugs on that plant, chances are that those thrips have laid eggs or have larvae existing in the soil. So when it's contained like that, it's great to go ahead and sprinkle that in there, and you'll be dealing with the issue. The thing is a lot of the times you're gonna be combating both beneficial and non-beneficial at the same time. It happens. It's really about encouraging some of those more beneficial bugs to stick around, planting some of these varieties of plants that I already mentioned, dill, cilantro, yarrow, sunflower, some other really great options. I love putting sunflower in my gardens. It's great for attracting pollinators, and the seeds are great for birds as well. Ruthie has asked, I have black swallowtail butterflies that lay eggs on my dill and monarch butterflies on my milkweed. How do I protect them from wasps? Great question. For monarchs, and you know, if you're able to container garden, that's kind of a great way. If you really want to encourage those monarchs, I have just some seedlings of milkweed that I have growing right now, and I'm actually going to not only plant it in my garden, but I'm also going to plant it in some containers so that I'm able to put those in spots where wasps maybe aren't going to be as attracted to, for example. So, you know, wherever you have a whole lot of flowers planted, where you have a whole lot of bright, colorful flowers that wasps are going to be attracted to, you can maybe plant your milkweeds or your other plants that your swallowtail caterpillars are attracted to in a different area of your yard, if you can, so that those pollinating wasps are maybe more attracted to the brightly colored parts of your garden. Okay. Margaret asks, how do you deal with coddling moths for apple trees? These are a tough one, similar to gypsy moths. They're really tough. Again, I would recommend introducing beneficial bugs. Think about praying mantises. That would be great. Think about lacewing larvae. Those are fabulous too. They can be a great way for, they're a great option to introduce to your apple trees for managing some of the larvae and eggs. Another great thing that you can do is just using soapy water, spraying it down. Those would dehydrate and essentially kill larvae, eggs, and actual moths is with soapy water. So you can try that as well. It might be helpful for you. Teresa says, flea beetles are eating everything. What works for them? If you can find where these beetles are congregating, for example, diatomaceous earth is kind of like, sometimes you either have to use multiple things, try something, doesn't work, try something else, doesn't work, try something else, or using a few different things together and trying that. So for those beetles, what I would recommend is maybe diatomaceous earth. That could be an option. Sometimes removing the food source. So if you're finding that these beetles are really attracted to your tomato plants and your container gardening, maybe move those tomato plants to a different part of your yard, maybe bring them inside, maybe move them to your front porch, something like that. Removing the food source can sometimes be helpful. Or look into purchasing some parasitic wasps. Purchase some praying mantises. They'll eat all of those. They'll attack all of those. Helen has asked, I've noticed some bugs on my snap peas that look a bit like ticks. Do you know what they might be and if they're going to cause problems? This is a tough one to answer, especially without seeing a photo. And unfortunately, a lot of things look like a tick. A lot of things look like a little black beetle. And in fact, ticks aren't even beetles. They're arachnids. They've got 8 legs. Insects are anything with 6 legs. Okay, fun fact. Would be tough. I would say a good way to know if your plants are being affected by these beetles is, are you noticing insect activity? Are they eating parts of your leaves? Are your plants looking unhappy or unwell? That's a great thing to look into. Something that I've done for tomato plants that I find can work is I'll dilute 400 milligrams of aspirin. Believe it or not, aspirin probably exists in most people's medicine cabinet. I'll dilute that in about a gallon of water. And I'll spray my tomato plants with that because there's a hormone that tomato plants excrete when they're under attack. And it's very similar to the salicylic acid that exists in aspirin. So if you're spraying your tomato plants with that, it kind of tricks the tomato plant into thinking that it's got to kick its immune system into overdrive. So it's a great way for your tomato plant to have its immune system working overtime so that it's able to fight off pests and disease. So that's something that may work for you as well. Bill, how do you deal with cutworms? Cutworms are just, when I first discovered cutworms, I was like, whoa, these are crazy. They basically will chop all of your plants off. Like they'll just eat around the ring of your plant. And again, one of the best ways to avoid cutworms is cutworms typically like to attack young foliage. And if you had an issue last year that you're really wanting to try and combat this year, and this is going to be hard for most people, but my best advice is to wait to plant, because a lot of the times these larvae are coming up starving, hungry, they're ready to eat. And if there's no food source for them because you wait maybe a week, 2 weeks before you get your young plants into the ground, they'll ultimately starve. So it kind of puts a little bit of pressure on us as gardeners. I know the wait is already too long as we're waiting through the winter months to get our crops into the ground. But truly, if you had an issue last year or previous years, sometimes waiting to get those young plants into the ground is a great way to starve out cutworms and other bad bugs. Okay, try that out. Wendy, how to combat spider mites on large spruce trees with nematodes? You can use nematodes. Spider mites, what I like to do, for starters, ladybugs, their larvae will eat spider mites. You can use insecticidal soap. That works great. You can even sprinkle diatomaceous earth. Okay, that's something that you can put on the leaves of your plant, no problem. And that can kind of have an effect on spider mites as well. Spider mites are the worst. I use beneficial spray. Not beneficial spray. I'll use insecticidal soap. I just made that up, beneficial spray. I don't even know where that came from. Insecticidal soap. It comes in a concentrate, you dilute it, and you can spray it, okay? But with spider mites, that's something that you have to kind of constantly keep up with doing to manage. But I found, again, using nematodes and that insecticidal soap is what really combated spider mites for me. Another thing that you can use is neem oil. How many people here have used neem oil? Neem oil is amazing. It's kind of smelly. You can buy it at most garden centers or online. But neem oil, you dilute in water. You add a little tiny bit of dish detergent to kind of help to mix it all together. And what I'll do is I'll spray affected areas. And what I've actually also started doing is watering my plants with a little bit of diluted neem oil in it. And what that helps with is actually, of course, the plant takes that neem oil up into its vascular system and it prevents or wards off bad insects. So you can use it both topically and you can water your plants with it as well. And it helps to prevent bad bugs, both indoors and outdoors. Okay, neem oil, fabulous stuff. Okay, Charles, how to control small green larvae on rose bush leaves? It would have to know what the larvae are. You can try any of the options that I've already mentioned. Beneficial insects will work great. Diatomaceous earth. You can do the pick and squish method. I actually did that with my cabbage worms. I had cabbage worms that were eating my Brussels sprouts. And I only had a couple. But again, it kind of just, it's about monitoring. It's like taking a minute to take a closer look because they blend in so well with those Brussels sprouts. And I just picked them up, squished them, haven't seen them since. So try that. Okay, Dave, I bought one of those bee and butterfly nests that looks like a dissected... dissected house with a bunch of tubes and slits. But I've never seen a single bee or butterfly use it. Do these not work? They definitely work. I have one of those too, Dave. What I would recommend you do is plant more butterfly, bee, pollinator friendly plants around that little house. They're called insect hotels. You may not see them, but they definitely do use them. Butterflies, not so much, but I've seen a lot of different ground beetles. I've even seen bees and hoverflies, which are a really, really fabulous pollinator. A lot of people think that it's just bees that are our pollinators, but it's flies, it's ants, it's beetles, it's so many different insects. So these insect hotels are beyond butterflies and bumblebees. They provide a safe space for so many insects. I have one in my garden and I love it. Okay. Wendy, my broccoli and cauliflower leaves are being decimated by something. Lots of small holes leading to big ones, leaving the leaves to look almost lacy. I've not seen any visible bugs. We do battle slugs, but keep them under control with eggshells. What I would recommend is, I would imagine that that's cabbage worms. Cabbage worms love to go after cruciferous vegetables like our broccoli, our kale, are Brussels sprouts, and they're really hard to see. I mean, they're big enough, but seriously, they look like veins on your leaves. So take a closer look, and it's possible that you have cabbage worms. Another thing that I've heard of people doing is sprinkling cornstarch. Cornstarch on these cabbage worms, and they will basically kind of puff up and die. So that's something you can try too. I'm not sure if anyone's ever tried that. Let me know in the comments if you have. KWG on YouTube is asking if this session is being recorded. And just so you guys at home know, this session is recorded. All of our sessions are recorded and are available on the Lee Valley Tools YouTube channel. So if you ever need to come back to it, it is here for you. KWG says, sounds like flea beetle damage. That could be the case as well. Sean says that he has slugs on his pear tree. Yeah, that's, slugs are tough. I like to use diatomaceous earth when it comes to slugs. And I basically will sprinkle it a ring around the tree. I'll sprinkle it even on the slugs themselves. And that can really, really help with slugs. Okay. Okay, someone's asking a question about flies. What is the, scroll up there a little bit. Okay, we've got Helen from Kelowna, BC. We have a cherry tree, but we only get to eat a few before the flies come and lay eggs in them and destroy them from the inside out. We have been told that the only way to control them is to spray pesticides, costing more than it's worth. Is there any way to control these flies with other insects before they can lay their eggs? This is a really good question. You could try fly traps. I mean, you'd probably end up catching a whole lot of other things, but fly traps, just, I'm thinking of killing the adults before the adults are able to lay eggs, and that's ultimately like kind of what you want. Maybe try neem oil and mixing that in with, diluting it with your water, watering your apple trees with that. It's organic, it's non-toxic, so it's not gonna have a negative effect on your actual fruit. But kind of like I mentioned, neem oil is a preventative measure. So it's something about it that insects, that deter insects. So maybe try that. And that goes for anyone who has questions about how to deter a specific type of insect that's visiting your plants in a negative way. Maybe try the try neem oil. That can help sometimes. Bill Mars, how do you deal with blueberry maggots? I've never had to deal with blueberry maggots personally. But any sort of larvae, something that you can use is nematodes. Again, nematodes are those microscopic wingworms that can go into the soil and eat larvae, which maggots are a larvae of a fly, of a moth in some cases. It depends on the larvae. But try nematodes. That might be beneficial for you as well. Okay, I'm going to wrap up the session. Thank you all so much for your fabulous questions. If I didn't get a chance to get to your question or you have others, feel free to send me a note over Instagram. You can leave a comment in the Lee Valley Tools channel here and I'll hopefully get a chance to get to it. If you enjoyed this session, we do have a few other amazing ones coming up where I'm going to be interviewing one of Canada's amazing soil scientists in just a few weeks. We're also doing a session July 6th on worm composting, talking about how you at home can get started with making your own worm composting bin, making your own worm tea. We're going to talk about how amazing worm castings are if you want to really pump up your gardening game, both indoor and outdoor. Worm poop is where it's at. We're going to be talking all things worm poop. That's July 6th. Please make sure that you subscribe, like, follow the Lee Valley Tools channel here on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, so that you're not missing any of our upcoming awesome live stream events. As always, we love doing something with you guys. Feel free to let us know in the comments as well if there's a topic that you'd like covered. That's what we're here for. We're here to educate you. We're here to bring you all this awesomeness. So feel free to leave a comment. Thank you so much for tuning in today, and we will see you in the next live stream. Bye for now.